But when I read the verse of the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, which says, "Huwa allazi khalaqal layla wan nahar." It is Allah who has created the night and the day. Wa shamsa wal qamar, the sun and the moon. Kullun fi falaki yasbuhun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. So the Quran says, the sun and the moon, besides revolving, they also rotate about their own axis. The Arabic word used here is yasbuhun, derived from the Arabic word sabaha, which describes the motion of a moving body. If I use this Arabic word yasbaha for a person who's moving on the floor, it will not mean that he's rolling, it will mean he's either walking or running. If I use the same word for a person in the water, it will not mean he's floating, it will mean he's swimming. Similarly, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the same word for a celestial body, it does not mean that it is flying in the air, it means it is moving along with its own rotation. It is rotating about its own axis. So Quran says, the sun and the moon, besides revolving, it also rotates about its own axis. And today, science has discovered that even the sun rotates. Since we can't see the sun directly, you get blinded if you see directly. If you have an equipment and have the image of the sun on a tabletop, we find that there are spots in the sun. And it takes about 25 days for the spots to complete one rotation, indicating that the sun takes approximately 25 days to complete one rotation. Imagine when I was in school, I was taught the sun was stationary, didn't rotate about its own axis. And the Quran mentioned 14 years ago that it rotates. And now, alhamdulillah, most of the schools have incorporated that the sun also rotates. Further, we read in the Quran, it's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 40. It is not permitted for the sun to overtake the moon, nor the night to outstrip the day. The moon and the sun. Kullun fi falaki yasbuhun, each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. Now the scientists say that the orbit of the sun and the moon is different. So there's no question of the sun overtaking the moon. That's what the Quran says. And today the scientists, they tell us that the sun is moving in a direction in the universe to a particular fixed direction, which is called as the solar apex. In the constellation of Hercules, also known as Alpha Lyra, at a speed of 12 miles per second. And today the scientists, they tell us that the sunlight we have is due to a chemical reaction which is taking place since billions of years. And one day, this chemical reaction will cease. And so will the light of the sun cease to exist. And so will the life on this earth cease to exist. But the scientists say it will take another few billion years. Quran gives a similar message in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 38. وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ, that the sun is running its course for a period determined, to a place determined. The Arabic word used here is mustaqar, which has two meanings. Either it means for a period determined, or it means to a place determined. And today science says that the sun is moving to a particular spot known as solar apex, and it will exist for a particular time period. So both the meanings of mustaqar, to a place determined and for a period determined, according to science, is perfect. Imagine, Quran mentions this 1400 years ago. When I was in school, I had learned that there are three types of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. And previously, the scientists believed that the space outside the astronomical systems in the galaxy, it was vacuum. Lately, the scientists have discovered that there are bridges of matter in the interstellar space. It's not vacuum. And it is called as plasma. And they say this matter is in a form of gaseous matter, which has equal number of positive ions as well as electrons. And the Quran mentions 1400 years ago in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 59. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has created the heavens and the earth, as well as things in between it. So Quran says there is matter in between the heavens and the earth, which today science, they say that this plasma can be considered as the fourth type of matter. Today science also tells us that the atmosphere of the earth, it acts like a filter and prevents the harmful radiations from outer space to come onto the surface of the earth. It prevents the X-rays and the ultraviolet rays to reach the surface of the earth, which is very important for the sustenance of life. If this filter of the earth's atmosphere wasn't there, then life would not exist on the face of the earth. The Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 32, that we have made the sky as a protected ceiling. We have made the heavens, the Arabic word is samawat, we have made the heavens, that is the sky, as a canopy well guarded. Today science has come to know that this protected ceiling, without this, life would have ceased to exist on the face of the earth. It was in 1925, a very famous scientist by the name of Edwin Hubble and a famous astronomer, he said that the galaxies are receding. That means the universe is expanding. The Quran mentioned 14 years ago in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 47, that we have created the vastness of space. The Arabic word musyun means vastness or the expanding universe. The Quran mentions 400 years ago that the universe is expanding, which we have come to know recently, 80 years back, 90 years back. And according to Stephen Hawking, who's a very famous scientist, he writes in his book, The Brief History of Time, he says that the discovery of the expanding universe is the greatest discovery of the century, which is mentioned in the Quran 14 centuries before. There may be skeptics or some non-Muslims who will say it is nothing great that the Quran speaks about astronomy, since the Arabs were very well advanced in the field of astronomy. I do agree with them that the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy. But I'd like to remind them, it was centuries after the Quran was revealed that the Arabs advanced in the field of astronomy. So it is from the Quran that the Arabs learned about astronomy and not the vice versa. And there were many things about astronomy mentioned in the Quran which the Arabs didn't speak about and which we have come to know recently. In the field of physics, several centuries ago, there was a theory which was called as atomism. This was advanced by the Greeks, especially Democrats, who lived 2300 years before. And according to this theory of atomism, atom is the smallest part of matter. And this was also known to the Arabs. And the Arabic word for atom, in Arabic, it's called a zarra. And the Arabs also agreed the smallest part of matter, nothing can be smaller than that. And if you read the Quran too speaks about the atom. Now, after science advanced in the field of physics, we agree that atom is the smallest particle of matter having the characteristics of the element, but an atom too can be divided. So does it mean that the Quran is outdated? Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 3, as well as in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 61, that when they say, that is unbelievers, that the final hour will never come, tell them it will surely come by the Lord, in whose knowledge is the unseen, and in whose record is the smallest detail of an atom, and